Mr. Harleman, you have a friend here to see you.
No, I don't.
This is a bit grown up, isn't it?
Yep.
I saw the boys the other day.
Mm-hmm.
David? Little Richard?
He remembers the names of our podcasting friends, Rory.
We had ourselves a little idea.
Did you now?
Yeah, we're gonna go back to the Cornetto Trilogy.
Why?
For some unfinished business.
That's a joke, right?
Three hosts, one podcast, two great comedy actors.
More than three.
Ha, oh, ho, steady on, you crazy cinephiles.
I haven't seen that movie in 11 years, Roy.
You need to rewatch then. We can go back, see the flick, chew the fat, and it will be just like it always was, except this time, we're gonna finish this Right Peg Frost saga once and for all.
You have a very selective memory, Rory.
Thanks.
Why do you think none of us have reviewed it before?
I don't know.
Because it is a black hole. It's boring. It always was, and it always will be.
Wait a minute.
It's only boring because we haven't reviewed it.
It's pointless arguing with you.
Exactly. So come on, let's boo-boo.
In a world where entertainment is viewed as mindless diversion, only good for momentary distraction, one podcast has taken a stand, thoughtfully engaging the art of our day, dissecting the narrative, and pointing the people back to the greatest storyteller of all. You are about to enter a new world, and you will never view entertainment in the same way again. This is Popcorn Theology.
Don't be afraid of your freedom!
Welcome, movie lovers and theologians. I can't sustain any sort of British accent for more than about 5 seconds, so never mind. Welcome, movie lovers and theology nerds, to episode 340 of Popcorn Theology, where we examine films for what we can receive, reject, and redeem for common ground, fruitful conversation, and mindful movie consumption. I'm James.
I'm Maddie.
And I'm Rory.
And we are looking at The World's End, directed by the wonderful Edgar Wright, and starring Simon Pegg, Nick Frost, Martin Freeman, and a host of others, including a couple of people you might not have been expecting until about halfway through the movie. So, five friends reunite in an attempt, or are sort of forced into a reunion to top their epic pub crawl from 20 years earlier, and they unwittingly become, well, maybe humanity's only hope for survival, or at least some kind of dramatic incursion. So, let's jump right into what we thought. No spoilers, and buttered and salted, fresh or stale. Do we think this movie was bad, good, or great? And maybe just a 1 minute reason why. I am gonna pick, well, let's actually go to our correspondent from across the pond and get the official thought from Rory.
Yeah, the only official report, as I say. Hello there. Yeah, I thought it was actually fresh, and it was, yeah, slightly disappointing perhaps the first time round, though, I have to admit. That was about 10 years ago, watched it in the cinema, and that's mainly because I had such a high buzz watching it with my friends, who were similar age to Gary King's friends in 2007, and that was such a thrill to watch Hot Fuzz together and laugh, or, you know, laugh so hard, and just, oh, belly was so aching. And while I appreciated the technically great, good, you know, how good it was technically, I didn't just connect with it at the time. I didn't connect with the character-driven story, and however, having grown up 10 years since I've grown to appreciate the more character-driven story, and now I'm closer to Gary King's age than I care to admit now, and with all the receding hairlines that go along with it, and I appreciate all the themes, and also a lot has changed in the UK. I mentioned the big bad B word, Brexit, so things have made, there's layers to it in terms of British culture I appreciate more, that we go into later. Yeah.
So that's why you're wearing the hat? Is that because of the hairline?
Yeah, covering the hairline.
I don't want a before and after.
Oh, right on. So a little disappointed. Saw it 11 years ago. So Maddie, did you see it when it came out or later? And what did you think?
No, I didn't. When did I first see this? I think I first saw it last year, actually. I had seen both Hot Fuzz and Shaun of the Dead, not when they came out, also later. It just, they weren't on my radar, but I really loved Hot Fuzz. My brother-in-law introduced me to that one, I think. He's a cop, so that would make sense why he would like Hot Fuzz.
Nice.
But this one was free on Amazon for a while, and it kind of popped up in my recommended. You know, it's like, hey, we think you might like this. And I watched it there, and I have to say that I really loved it right off the bat, even having seen the two previous ones. So I would say it's fresh. Maybe my favorite. I don't know. It's a real tie between that one and Hot Fuzz, as I really like those. It felt a little bit deeper than the other two while still being hilarious and just fantastic filmmaking because of Edgar Wright and, you know, the same witty dialogue. And I've watched it like probably four times now, and I feel like it just gets funnier.
Wow. So you're maybe your favorite of the three, but only fresh.
Yeah. Again, like, there's issues that I could talk about later, which I think you guys mentioned too, with like the ending. But it's still like overall, like with all the movies coming out, like even just in the past 10 years, like this is still a really fantastic movie. Like I can't say that it's not good. It's like, I might have, you know, like one or two things that I have a slight issue with, but you know, other than that, still a really great film.
All right. Well, I'll go with fresh too, so we're all tied on the rating. I honestly was a little more like Rory. Came out very. I was actually pretty disappointed after my first viewing because I was a huge fan. Well, a huge fan of Edgar Wright, a huge fan of Simon Pegg and Nick Frost. Up to that point, I loved Shaun of the Dead. Saw that in the theater. Saw Hot Fuzz in the theater. Not to mention Spaced. Their series came before that. It just a lot of good stuff. Anyway, but. So I came out thinking it was definitely the least of the three. I probably still think that, but upon repeat viewing, I really do enjoy it. I just feel it's, for me, it's probably the least, because I'd probably put those other two as buttered and salted. But I'd say the same. For me, it's as far as the Cornetto Trilogy, I would liken it to the original Star Wars Trilogy. It's like, I love Return of the Jedi, but it's my least favorite of the three. It's for me, it's 2-1-3. And so, and that might be the way it might be. I love Shaun of the Dead. But I think Shaun of the Dead's probably best in terms of craft, to my mind, just because it's such a sharp parody and very specific. But Hot Fuzz, I think, is ultimately like my wife and I probably think it's the funniest and probably have shown it to most, more of our friends. We spread the love kind of like you came into it. So, so all think it's fresh, but what about the theological depth? That can be always different. Is it kind of diluted? Is it carbonated? Or is the cup running over? Back to you, Roy. What do you think?
Yeah, I'll use UK English, perhaps. Fizzy, like a heavily shaken tin of Carling beer. Yeah, that's nice. That translates, yes, I know. Had to do that, drop that one in there. And it appears deep, I think, but it has a lot of froth, I think, and substance in some ways, but in terms of its ideas. But it is a very personal story about Pegg's journey, Simon Pegg's journey towards sobriety from alcohol, which I suppose has a depth to it. But I don't think the ideas that Carrick tried to pin that on don't work. And I think, but however, you know, there are things like social commentary from the UK, you know, like Wetherspoonsization, Starbucking, all pubs looking the same. Brexit makes people feel, well, I can't take back control of my life. My town's changed. I haven't changed. Lots of these things. So, but typical Britons, we just moan and groan and just tell you, just go away. So, yeah, typical British folks. More moans than answers. That's the problem. It's a bit British. Sure.
Maddie, what about you?
I thought it was pretty carbonated. Foamy, if you will. I was honestly shocked with the deep themes that I could probably come up with, especially on this just last viewing, because, you know, we're paying more attention since we're actually doing it for the podcast. And I just think it's got some really good commentary on growing up, romanticizing the past, disappointment, government or alien overreach versus unrestricted freedom. So just good stuff. I could probably choose a lot of things to talk about, but like Rory said, sometimes it doesn't always have the answers to those things, but it brings up a lot of ideas for you to think about.
Yeah, I totally agree. We're all going with fizzy, I guess. Carbonated it is. And I think there's a lot to talk about. But as you guys have been alluding to, I'll say up front, I think this movie is where I think what we need to learn is more in opposition to some of the messaging that we're given. There's probably a little more reject and redeem than receive as far as the messages in this
movie.
Agree with that. But maybe not all of them. So we'll certainly get into some of that. And we're all on the same page as far as all fresh, all carbonated. So it'll be interesting to see. But we know. But we have some difference on the actual liking as far as how high we would rate the film. So we'll see where we land on various interpretations of the themes after our ads. But before we get to the movie, we do want to remind anyone who's watching to like and share this episode with friends, broaden the conversation, subscribe to us on YouTube. If you're listening to us on your podcast feed, we're actually now on YouTube. Video versions, all the best stuff. You get yes. to see us, you know, occasionally wearing a Popcorn Theology merch
yeah.
or dressed up or putting on our best Gary King. So
you do look like a lot like
broaden the conversation. I said my hairline receded a lot farther than Rory's. So, you can also support us on Patreon. So you could just for $1 a month or. What would that be in pound? £1 a month?
Is it equal? I don't know.
Well,
No, it's exchange rates, admin fees. I think I pay about $3, which is about three.
Hey, all you Patreon fans, look at that. People all the way over in the UK are willing to pay $3. So maybe it's for as little as $3.
Strong dollar, as they say.
There you go. You can support us and make more of these episodes happen. Even vote on future episodes. I know this is comedy month, and so we're just kicking things off. And I know our supporters have already voted on what we'll be doing at the end of the month, but I'm not going to spoil the surprise just yet. So lots of other stuff going on. Be sure to visit the merch store, and we will be back in just a moment with more on The World's End.
Popcorn Theology has been mindfully viewing cinema from a godly perspective since 2015. But why? Where did it come from? Well, one of the inspirations was our host James Harleman's book, Cinemagogue, published in 2012, exploring the intersections between film and faith. And now, fresh off the press, is an updated edition of the book, The Cinemagogue Director's Cut. This version contains over 40 pages of new content with reviews and recommendations, movie references, illustrations, further shaping the story-formed argument for God's existence while also delving deeper on hot topics like how we deal with sex and nudity in film. It's the how-to guide for all things popcorn theology. And this time, it's not just available on Kindle and in paperback, but also a hardcover edition for all you true book lovers. So if you like movies, if you're a cinephile, if you spend hours talking film, this book is definitely for you. Or if you're a casual consumer who thinks movie making exists merely for diversion, this book may just change your life. Cinemagogue, available now at Amazon.com. For bulk orders or signed copies, check out cinemagogue.com for details.
Hey, this is James, and if you're listening to Popcorn Theology, it's because you're interested in movies, or theology, or best of all, both. And that probably means you're our kind of people, sharing things in common with our community, and maybe sharing common interests our listeners and viewers would be interested in as well. So why not partner with us and advertise your business or ministry right here on Popcorn Theology? We're looking for great, like-minded sponsors and offer reasonable rates with a variety of formats to get your message out. Remember, our fans aren't mindless consumers, so they'll give you thoughtful consideration. That's big part of what we're all about. So for more information on advertising with us, contact info@popcorntheology.com. we're back, ready to start our theme crawl, as it were. I don't know if we'll get to all 12 themes that are in this movie, although we might be able to dig up that many before if we wanted to drink deeply. But before we get to those deep theological themes, let's spend a little more time talking popcorn, shall we? Mm-hmm. So we will enjoy a little, get it nice and buttered. Sadly, I'm just drinking rain.
Rain. Yeah, we laughed pretty hard. I watched this movie with my friends last night. I just had a movie night, and everyone burst into laughter at that line.
Oh, no crowning right glory. On. No.
I know. It's just really, we couldn't quite, I couldn't justify drinking in the morning since it is. Rory's the only one who could be drinking because it's, I think, 5 p.m. there.
Yeah, 5 o'clock somewhere.
Yep, defo.
Well, see, we should have done that. We should have, okay, Rory, it's 5 o'clock where Rory is, so I guess we can all raise a pint, but...
Yeah.
Next time. So, Rory, you, since you are ahead of us in so many ways, as well as your country and culture, and sadly, if I read the statistics right, maybe even the post-Christian is on ahead of us, too.
Man. Yeah, that's true. Because you're totally right in that. Because even if I say what's the most Christian city in Eastbourne in lots of the UK, you think that's nothing compared to even Seattle beats how Christian it is compared to Eastbourne. that's how I compare the two. Wow. You know, one pastor you said, well, we're the least church city in America. I'm like. No. Look over the pond, mate. But yeah, you're right. Anyway, wow. That's an aside.
Yeah. So what stood out for you as far as what you just loved in general about enjoying this comedy? And a wonderful delight with wonderful cast.
Obviously. Yeah, of course. What stood out? Well, obviously, I quite like the premise of just bringing the team back together, the game, bringing the gang back together to your town, see what one guy. I just like that kind of character driven story, and I think I tapped into that a lot more given my life experience. You know, Gary King played by Simon Pegg, just absolutely nailing that character. I think he's played that role significantly in different ways. You know, a kind of man child kind of need to grow up in some ways, like whether you've Hot Fuzz or not of us. I know. I mean, Shaun of the Dead, especially. I think it carries on some of that maturity arc there in a different way. Quite like that. Love the action sequences and lots of that. And yeah, my emotional maturity. I know that it's my receding hairline has been referred already before, and may get worse as I watch this. I liked how it is a reflection of the 12 steps that Simon Pegg went through to get through over his alcohol addiction. In some ways, you have 12 pubs, 12 steps, and or how not to get over an alcohol addiction, if you know what I mean. I would probably put that caveat there. Of course, all the action sequences, I think, are entirely realistic in some ways, given some bar fights and beer gardens that I've been close to in my lifetime, apart from the aliens and the blue blood. So yeah, but
hopefully no crushed heads or lost limbs.
No, hopefully not. Hopefully, yeah, no. Well, maybe they're terrifying twins, but yeah. No. I, if you know my background already, I mean, I'm making jokes because I do come from a small town like Newton Haven, Thurso in Scotland, 8,000 people. You know, that's the far north coast of Scotland. You couldn't get any further unless, you just get your feet wet, basically, or get to Iceland. And so it is kind of Newton Haven meets Sanford kind of place, where there is the greater good. We reference another Cornetto flavor. Greater good. And, yeah, but in England, you'd have the parish church, the cricket pub, the cricket pitch, and the pub. All within a sort of triangular place. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what Newton Haven is. And yeah. And when I did turn 18, I also did go on a wee pub crawl with my friends because 18 is the legal drinking age here.
Woo-hoo. Yeah.
And of course, just the four or five of. Yeah, lucky. I know, 21 sucks, man, being that side of the pond. I know. I remember David. Yeah, David, Liam, Dan, James, and Tom. That's the gang, man. You know, was I Gary King? I don't know. And we also are Hot Fuzz together in 2007 as well. So, whoa, that's a double layer of personal meaning to it. And each one of us is our own distinctive characters as well. And I think 5 was enough for me before I called it a day. And I left everyone behind. I don't know what happened to the rest after that. it's just kind of nuts. So I think, yeah, that's why I related to that. It's a bit of a long-winded explanation, but that's just me. I know my upbringing, and that's why I think I saw things back. Would I go back to Thurso? Maybe. Maybe to appreciate it, not to have a pub crawl. In quite the same way as Gary King. Yeah. Anyway, what are you guys' thoughts in the whole film?
Well, I love that your reasoning for loving this movie is because you lived it.
Yeah.
That is maybe pretty cool.
Maybe it's better than I thought. Or not.
So, yeah, Maddy, maybe a different story?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely didn't grow up in a small town in England, but... But I did grow up in a small town in the U.S. I think, you know, there are definitely similarities there. I still live in a small town, and I'm one of those people who never left. So I didn't get turned into an alien yet, though, so or robot or a phobot.
That's exactly what a robot or alien would say.
Exactly. No, but I love this movie. I thought it was very fresh, maybe more from like a filmmaking perspective than anything. Just like the more I read about it, the more I watched it again, I've seen it like probably 4 times now. I just noticed different things. And even being like the least of the three or so they say, it's still very wonderful. And one of the things I noticed on this last one, which I had actually done some research on, was the names of the pubs and what happens in each scene. So each pub name indicates what's going to happen in that scene if you're paying attention. So like the first post, that's just first one, the old familiar, it's the same as the first pub, literally the same. The famous cock, Gary's kicked out because he was a cock. And the cross hands is the first fight, first blood, that's where they meet the aliens. Two-headed dog is the fight with the twins. The mermaid is where they're seduced by sirens. It all ties in. It was so wonderful seeing that level of detail tied into the story. Wow. And that's just Edgar Wright, you know, and being Edgar Wright. And it's wonderful to watch. And another foreshadowing thing that he does is the first pub crawl that they do is literally echoed in the second one. A lot of the same things happen in each bar. Like in the trusty servant, oh man, disappeared the first time. He disappears in the same bar that time where he's taken by the aliens. And the beehive, like in the first story, he's like, and things got mental at the beehive. And then when you go to the beehive the second time, it's when they talk about the hive mind and stuff. And I just love that. I just get very nerdy about stuff like this. And so I just really love that. That level of detail and plotting, it just really tickles me. So I love it.
Nice. Yeah, Edgar Wright is so wonderful with visual comedy. Visuals, words, just like nothing seems to be missed. I mean, like Baby Driver, same way. I just think about the opening sequence where he's moving and he's walking to where he's walking with the coffee, and like things, signs, like everything aligns with the story. And he manages to always do that in a pretty crazy way. So I think that the more you see his movies, the more you get out of it, whether it's Scott Pilgrim 2 and some of the other films that he's done.
Absolutely.
It is a very special form of comedy. I still lament that he didn't get to do Ant-Man, because that would have definitely added something unique to the MCU.
Oh, yeah. Would have made it better, absolutely. Probably.
Yep. A whole different world where we bring in Edgar Wright for comedy instead of Taika Waititi, but that's another story. The MCU could look very different if a few different directors. Somebody with such an eye for detail like Edgar Wright would have been fascinating to see. But
yeah,
but he makes good movies. They don't have to be Marvel movies. In fact, maybe it's better if they aren't Marvel movies. I love the way each film mixes the character dynamics. Like you were saying, Rory, in some ways this is a return because he's similar to who he was in Shaun of the Dead. Hot Fuzz then, he was like the reverse personality. Mm. And then, like, he and Nick Frost change character personalities in all three movies, absolutely. which is special in a way. Like most comedy duos, you know, you go back like Laurel and Hardy, Abbott and Costello, like the whole routine is you're always the same characters, like that you don't lose that dynamic, like David Spade, or like you usually have the straight man and the funny man, and I love that they kind of twist it around every time. And here he's like Sean, more like Sean, but Sean didn't have, like Sean had to learn the bravado, whereas here we have somebody with far too much, who's far too full of himself, and like they're both sort of checked out. They both need to grow up, but one needs to actually. Sean's developing his masculinity in Shaun of the Dead, and kind of stepping into a more adult role that also takes some toughness. Here, honestly, Gary could dampen it down a little bit.
Way down.
Yeah.
Yep.
But I have also done my own pub crawl, albeit it was at Disney World. But there are a dozen different countries, and I had let me make it clear, the park is open for 13 hours, but I did manage to hit all 12.
Wow.
You did good.
I did start in the morning. You just slow and steady wins the race. You. Don't get drunk. So I'll never do it again, but that was an experiment in pacing and moderation, and it worked. It can be done. But I would have liked a little more Martin Freeman. Because I love Martin Freeman, it would have been interesting to have him a little bit more. And he actually becomes a robot pretty soon into the movie, halfway through. Pierce Brosnan, again, nice surprise. That was just one of those things where you're like, oh my goodness, I didn't know he was going to show up in the movie. And the interplay and callbacks. By the way, what does WTF mean? We're not going to say on the episode.
I can translate for you, but I don't know if it means the same thing in your language as it does in mine.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Oh, man. Oh. But as I said, I felt like Shaun of the Dead was the tightest parody. Hot Fuzz was the funniest. And this one, to me, is more like Gary King. It's amusing and annoying at the same time. And so to the point where I couldn't quite find him adorable, whereas I found Shaun more adorable. Gary King in this is more like Michael Scott in The Office for me. Okay. Sometimes the frustration outweighs the fun. So but I know a lot of people love The Office. So that means that it's a comedy that may be more, maybe as a minister, people like that frustrate me. And like the people that are kind of stuck, they won't listen to reason and won't see the changes that maybe they need to make. So I don't know. That could be one of those little things where I'm a little too close to certain things, and characters of this frustrate me in certain ways. So I don't know. There's probably some therapy to be had there. But speaking of therapy or theology or the things of deeper discussion and analysis, it's probably that time. So let's move a little bit more into the spiritual themes and some of the stuff.
Cheers.
I think we'll. Nice. Yes.
It's root beer, absolutely. By the way. It's 11 a.m. here. Mm-hmm. I'm not drinking at 11.
Just tea.
Just tea. We can't see what he poured in there.
It's
so that's right. Well, always ahead, Rory. We're gonna go with you. What was one of the themes that stood out for you as you watched this movie?
Yeah. Ultimately, it was this you know, we wanted to see. There was this tension, I think, between a self-sacrificing glory versus a destructive self-serving glory. And I think that goes with Gary's quest to do 12 pubs. And the deeper layer is that it reflects Peg's alcoholism at the time. And that's where it seeps into the writing that Gary is a mentally ill man as well. He's trying to overcome his past glory, and he's trying to do that by accomplishing these 12 steps through getting heavily drunk and running on alcohol to do so, actually to the destruction of his own peers. And he's trying to get that crowning glory, that pint of crowning glory from his youth, and trying to attain that seems impossible. And just looking through that, well, 12 pubs, 12 steps, I mean, in terms of Alcoholics Anonymous as the steps to sobriety, I think there's quite a parallel there. I don't think that's deliberate, accidental, I should say. It is definitely deliberate there. And of course, He's wanting that crowning glory from every pub. Come on, one more, 12 more, one more, one more. But he's disappointed when they serve the same pint of Foster's. Sorry, F. It's a kind of faux Aussie lager, and it's kind of bleh. It's a bit, it doesn't, you have to super chill it to make it taste any good. Sorry, guys, if you love Foster's, I'm sorry, but it's not a proper beer. It's not proper beer, right? And that's what he's looking for. I've insulted some section of our audience, but anyway, Foster's lovers, but anyway, but yeah. So I do share in Gary's dissatisfaction, but however, how he goes about it is not good, because if you look at what the 12 steps are, you admit you're powerless, you believe in there's a higher power that can help, you believe that you can control yourself, you can do lots of things, that you make amends, etc., and then you want to, etc., and there's 12 of them, and they all mention a higher power, but there's no, this film rejects a higher power. They're saying, no, the higher power is actually stopping me from getting my crowning glory. You've made things so generic and indistinct. I don't want that higher power. So that kind of defeat, that kind of undermines his, anyway, I feel that undermines in the writing anyway, and what sobriety really is, because he does get there in the end. And that there are some good aspects to that, like de-romanticization, I think, you know, the past and things like that. That is critical, I think, is presenting that, showing. But that's why it's not a truly satisfying and sober conclusion, because the world just blows up. Then you're like, he's got a soberness. He's got sober at the end. But in the end, he's in the interest of Van Helsing kind of... Is it Van Helsing, James? You can correct me. Kind of attire, you know, at the end.
Yeah.
Then the pub.
Yeah.
Or if there's alcohol left. And Mad Max kind of imagery. He's got 5 sober friends. And all he says, all we're here to do is to have a good time. Real friends worth fighting for. And he just wants another group of friends that kind of replace the ones that he's blown up. and kind of sacrificed in his quest for glory. So, yeah. I feel that speaks into, I think, a certain scripture, like Jeremiah 2, where my people have committed 2 evils, they have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed out cisterns for themselves, broken cisterns that can hold no water. So that sense of, he's drinking from a broken cistern. It was never perfect. It was never good in the first place. And if John 7 says, and said, Jesus says, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. So, and obviously all the verses like in Ephesians 4, you say, do not get drunk with wine, for that's debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. Whoop, charismatic in me goes, yes, be filled with the Spirit, man, gotta get the Spirit. but yeah, ultimately, if he is to look to a Jesus who did accomplish everything he probably needs, he wants in life, that for his failures, made up for it. Jesus did it by sacrificing himself. It says he didn't, as it says in Philippians 2, he came out from, he took the form of a servant, humbled himself to the point of death, a death on a cross, and therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name above every name. So, name higher than Gary King, the legend. And so, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, not 5 friends to bow at the knee or accompany the knee of Gary King. And in heaven on earth, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So the story that Frost is telling in retrospect is the legendary glory of Gary King and how he accomplished the quest of the 12 pubs. Whereas we worship Jesus, who actually did go through everything we've managed to fulfill what we failed to do. And that's ultimately a more sacrificing glory that doesn't wipe mankind out in the process, but brings people in who are hurt, just as hurt as Gary's, the Gary's of our world. And yeah, I don't, guys, what do you guys think of those themes there about self-sacrifice or self-destruction?
I was just reminded where scripture says, do not say, the former days were better than these. And honestly, that's hard. I mean, we've even talked a little bit about being post-Christian in terms of growing up, things were different. It's pretty easy to glorify or romanticize the past. I think a lot of people do that. Look back either at the 80s. It's kind of the 80s is the popular thing now, Stranger Things. Or when I was growing up, it was the 50s. or maybe it's that 70s show. It's like, oh, that was a simpler time. It's like, you know what? Yes, scripture warns us of that. You just see in the life of the people of Israel, like, yeah, there's always ups and downs, and they come and go. Like, we might thank God for a trouble-free period in our life, but we can't look back and say it was better, because were we better? Hopefully I'm more sanctified now than I was back in that decade I loved so much better. If God's at work in my heart, so what are we measuring by? What do we think? It would be that these days were better. It's like, you know, romanticizing the high school days, whether you're the jock or whether you're the, I was a speech and debate guy. Yay, valedictorian. Valedictorian, by the way, in a small town, my GPA was a 3.7. That was the highest in the class, just to be clear. That's no laudable event. That's just, I by default was the least dumb, I guess. I don't know what the but shout out to my all my old schoolmates. But yeah, we can easily glamorize a certain period in our life and think it was the best or better, and try to recapturing it when we should be moving forward to what God would have us be doing in this period of our life. And that sort of recapture thing is a terrible trap. And we see Gary is caught up in that, and he hasn't, or maybe he's not even trying to recapture it. Like, he's never left it.
Yeah, no.
In a weird way.
I would say that.
And he needs to move on. So yeah, no, I love, I'm picking up what you're putting down. And ultimately that is a self-destructive mode to be in, because there's no growth. What about you, Maddy?
Yeah, I'm kind of thinking, I was trying to find the quote here, which I think, you know, because you were talking about, you know, self-serving versus glorifying God, and like his definition of freedom and what that means. And I was thinking of the quote by Peter Marshall: may we think of freedom not as the right to do as we please, but as an opportunity to do what is right. That would be the better message than his definition of freedom, which is do whatever I want, when I want, when I want to do it. Again, very selfish, self-satisfying, overindulgence. This whole movie is overindulgence. But I don't think, I will say that I don't think the movie is glorifying in that, but I feel like it's very mixed messaging, which I'll get to that in my next point, in my point. But I totally get how watching this, you can kind of get that feeling that it's kind of celebrating it, because it is in a way, but then it isn't in a way.
Yeah. Let's hear your, let's shift into your area then, Maddy. What was on your mind as you were watching this, the fourth time, I guess?
Yeah. So my main theme was basically, this movie is about exposing our sin, you know, and about that over, you know, showing that overindulgence. And I really liked what you said earlier, James, because it really ties into my point about how you said you didn't like Gary Kane because he reminded you of Michael Scott from The Office. But that is the point. I mean, you're not supposed to like Gary Kane. He is not the hero here. You know, you're not David. Because that's what I feel, because a lot of people have told me that they don't like The Office just for that reason. They're like, I can't stand Michael Scott. And I'm like, you're not supposed to like him. I'm like, he is the person that you're like, no, he's uncomfortable, he's awkward, he's strange, and he's wrong, you know, and it is. And it's the same thing with Gary Kane. Gary, he kind of wants the good, but his definition of a good time is flawed. And you know that. And it takes the whole movie to change that, to expose his sin and his disappointment with life and how it is mostly his fault. He has to come to some sort of accountability. When Andy says to him, you know, near the end, like, how do you know if you're drunk if you're never sober? And I love that line, because it really indicates what Gary Kane is all about. And that line indicates that there is a higher moral good, right, wrong, even if they never actually explore it. But it indicates that you have to get there logically, even if they don't, even if they reject it in this movie, saying that there's no God or whatever. And that's where the movie ultimately gets messy, is when they actually try to define what the good is. You know, they're like, it's just good friendship. You know, it's about having good friends to rely on. And that is shallow and less than satisfying. And it would take more than that to change somebody. And I just was thinking of Ephesians 5:11 when it says, take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. And again, I think this movie does expose all his sins. And like in each pub, you kind of learn a bit more about Gary Kane. He's selfish. Like we've already established that with Rory's point. He's actually a bully. And you find that out on the pub where Peter is confessing how he was bullied. And Gary just doesn't care. Like he's like, shots. You know, he's ready to, you know, again, self-serving glory. He just wants to finish this. He doesn't care that Peter was bullied. And he even says in the first monologue that like, yeah, we normally wouldn't hang out with somebody like Peter. But he was minted, you know, he had a lot of money. And so I don't even think that he actually liked Peter that much. And he is a bully. He bullies everyone else. And he just keeps repeating all these mistakes from the past in the when they get to the cross hands, when they first fight the aliens. He's frustrated when he goes to the bathroom and he goes to punch the wall. And then there's that same tile that he cracked all those years ago. He's just repeating all the same mistakes. And that's such a good visual of you seeing that. And again, each pub, he's just continuing to do the selfish thing, the wrong thing. And really, it's Andy who's the, I would say, the morally better person, even though he doesn't have a good basis for morality either. But Andy's the one that you really latch on to. Andy's the mature one. He learned a lot from his mistakes in the past, especially with that car crash. And yet he's still loyal to Gary. And in that last, in the hole in the wall pub, I think it was the one before that, I don't remember. But he runs off, you know, because he wants to go finish it. And they were all going to get in the car and leave. And Steven says, don't, man, like, don't follow him. Like, he left you. And Andy says, I can't. Like, I have to go after him. And I just saw this, like, Frodo and Sam dynamic. And, like, because Sam's the real hero. Everyone knows that, you know. And that's how I saw kind of as Andy was actually. Andy was the faithful friend, the solid rock, the glue that held everyone together. And he actually does help Gary expose his sin, you know, when he finally realizes that Gary tried to commit suicide at one point, you know, when they finally show the bandages on his wrist and the hospital band, he's like, you need help. Like, this is why you wanted to do this, wasn't it? It was, you know, you're mentally unstable and you need help. And again, like, I think it's a little deeper than we think it is at first, but it does get messy in the end when they try to, you know, like, but we still want to get loaded and be free to do whatever we want. It's mixed messaging, essentially. So you got to watch out for that.
Yeah. You know, I hadn't really thought about it. That's excellent. Seeing it four times helps because you start to look, I think, beyond Gary to the other characters and probably get a little more analytical. Because the Andy angle really does help. It reminds me of two Proverbs as you were talking. Just the, you know, it talks about how there's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. And really, he does kind of do that for him. And there also Proverbs says, faithful are like the wounds of a friend are faithful.
Yes.
You know, the kisses of an enemy are actually bad, right? If somebody just kisses your butt is not helpful. Someone is, you know, faithful are the wounds of a friend when a friend will actually dive in and say the things that he does to him. You've already quoted. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah. If I could guess a lot of the friendship quotes in scripture and especially there in the Proverbs, probably pretty applicable to Andy if you did a more of a deep dive on that. Yeah. What do you think, Rory?
Yeah, absolutely. I think when Gary King on his own, I would not want to hang with him because what he would get me to do, imagine a character. I can imagine characters like him in the town I grew up. You know, wanting to relive the former glory days and etc. And like it's not what it's cracked up to be. And I kind of would be the reluctantly dragged in from the fringes. I'm like, no, I never actually wanted to come back here ever, but I guess I'm gonna have to. So I think I would through that. But yeah, honestly, I think as you're saying, I do agree with you that the friends help to show him up who he truly is. You know, I think there's one bit where he says, "Oh, he gave me 600 back." And that's obviously the bribe.
Oh, yeah.
His friends come back. It's funny. He bought 200 off every one of us.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he's
again,
not
he just uses
changed.
People.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's just crazy. Well,
and I don't think, you know, other than the sobriety, I mean, yeah, he's basically, the sad thing is he kind of has achieved everything he wanted at the end because he has now the high school versions of him. He has his mates. Yeah. Now, forever at the age that he loved them hanging out, he can go around and do that. He can get into the bar fights and have all the stuff. He's just doing it sober. So it's like the only thing that changed was no alcohol. And I'm not even sure he did that for the right reasons because there's that earlier scene. I forget how Andy talks up how drinking water is actually the toughest and most. So that's the toughest kind of baller move that you can do is actually to drink water instead. So I'm thinking he probably just took it on because he thinks it makes him more badass, right? It's not really the right reason.
No.
The thing is,
these days teetotalism is the in thing actually. Water and sobriety. Mm. It's strange. Mm. It seems to be the other way these days. But anyway, that's an interesting cultural
trend.
Another
form of virtue signaling.
Well, yeah, maybe.
could be. Again, what's the reasoning? Is it if you take a pride in it, well, then biblically we've got another problem.
Yeah. Right.
If it's being wise and if it's seeking to be as prudent as possible, okay, nothing wrong with abstinence. Nothing wrong with being a teetotaler. Provided it's personal, right? That's, you just don't go legalism, and that's. That's probably where I think we're supposed to hate the network and some of those things.
Yeah,
I'm gonna guess is like we're supposed to not like the network because it represents that kind of rigid structure and everybody has to do everything a certain way.
Yeah,
I get it.
Yeah,
I get where even as a Christian you could almost make some parallels too. Okay, that's. Like it's like the Pharisees trying to make everyone like them and follow all of the extra rules and
I think when you unhinge that from a God, you know, from Christianity, I don't believe that people act, you know, utterly immoral all over the place. I believe that people get more preachy about their behavior. If I'm twisting Dostoevsky there, and I think that's kind of where it goes, isn't it? People like being religious about different things. It's just that I'm religious about something different to you. But anyway, that's an aside there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and that's where I think we're all tracking on a similar theme. I think I came away very much struck by, I think one of the reasons I didn't like the movie 11 years ago was just, to me, the end felt like it was kind of preaching a sermon that I wouldn't agree with.
Yeah.
In that conversation with the network. Okay. And watching it again, I can see the humor. I see the humor in it. It's funny for what it is. The network doesn't really work as any direct parallel for God, so I can throw it away. But still, the theme I come away with, even watching it now, is it's the idea that the movie is really projecting in my mind is loving our sin and rejecting a savior, mm-hmm. right? I actually kind of realized this. I was prepping a sermon. And I plan to use an illustration from the old, I don't know if you've ever seen a movie, Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, there's a 50s
parallels.
Version.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a 50s version, but I think this one's most like the 70s version because Donald Sutherland actually kind of does that thing where he raises up the hand and like, kind of does the noise that comes out. Yeah. And they're robots. So it's kind of like the Stepford Wives, which thematically is kind of a similar kind of story. And those movies get remade or parodied in some fashion at least once every decade, which makes me think, okay, there's something that's tapping into here in the human condition that has something deeper. And I think we can make some parallels to that could be the world trying to conform us to be like them. So you could try to take a redemptive Christian angle. Mm-hmm. And I think that's in there, right? Or Or it could be, right, the legalists trying to make everybody cut their hair the same way and no more dancing and no more drinking. And you could try to run with those themes, but I think it's pretty clear in this movie and others, like part of the reason even Christians we push back on that, it's because we like to hang on to our sin. Like you think about it, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, it literally, you're not turned into a robot, you come out of this pod, but it's like you're being born again. Mm-hmm. Which, right? It's like, okay, the old you needs to die, you need to be born again. You need a new body. It's like, oh, wait, I have Christian parallels for all of this. And then what really then is very convicting, as I actually grabbed the dialogue from The Network and Gary King, right? The Network says, your planet is the least civilized in the entire galaxy. And translation, we're a bunch of, well, we'll say screw-ups. They say something else. But and Gary King says, it's our basic human right to be screw-ups. This civilization was founded on screw-ups. And you know what? That makes me proud. It's like, wow, that is, we want to be free. We want to be free to do what we want to do. And we want to get loaded. And at that point, Andy's agreeing with him. And he's like, yeah, come on. And the Network says, it's pointless arguing with you. You will be left to your own devices. And then the Network even goes out with some profanity. But so we have this supreme external force that wants to conform us to its image. And in this film, all the characters, especially Gary King, comfortable in his own skin or in his own sin, he's living a debauched and stunted life under the sun. Like everyone, they tell the powers above to go screw themselves, right? And really, the supreme voice says, you're hopeless, and leaves them in darkness. It actually made me think of Philippians 3. It says, for many of whom I have often told you and now tell you with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction, their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with minds set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. Right? So I think some of our fear and loathing of movies like Body Snatchers, Stepford Wonder, The World's End is like, we don't want to give up. The idea of giving up entirely our old selves is anathema to us. The idea of giving up some of our sin nature, the aspects we love to glory in and still hold on to. And the idea of being reborn or conformed on the one hand has some allure, but on the other hand, we don't want to let go of stuff. And so like, I don't know if that's a hot take on the movie, but it is a pretty harsh take. So is that, what do you guys think?
Yeah, no, I totally actually agree. I mean, the whole thing of like being conformed and conformity is not something British people like, you know, don't tell us what to do. It's the attitude, you know, whilst the contradiction with that is we're so polite. We want to get on. If change happens, oh, we don't want to rock the boat. We're not so let's basically throw some tea overboard, you know, things like that. If you start a revolution, revolutions.
Oh yeah,
the revolution.
We learned it from watching you.
Well, the revolutions in the UK are a bit slower, and can catch you out, as they say. But you know, I get it. You know, no one likes, you know, this story. In some ways, it is a tragedy. You know, it isn't a true comedy because we do see evil and sin come to fruition. And, you know, and a similar way to British people's view of God, it's kind of like, it's just another unaccountable, faceless boss, politician, the Network. He doesn't like diversity. He wants everyone to be the same and think the same. And I guess that's part of a lot of reasons Brexit happened is because, you know, and in this country, you know, we don't like being told what to do. Things haven't changed. Things were the best sometime in the past. Don't know when. So we want to make Britain better again. Sorry, that's some parallel. I'm trying not to make. There are some similar parallels to the US and in small town US, I guess. And that's kind of how things are. Because how dare a politician tell me how to run my life? And that's British people's attitude. But then people say, oh no, we have to keep things the same. We don't want to rock the boat too much because too much change is not a good thing. They'll come down hard on us and cancel us, basically. But I think from a God that we know, I think all tribes, tongues, and nations will be there. And there's a diversity. It's not like we're all going to think exactly the same. I mean, we're all going to love God. And I'm sure there will be fine British pubs in towns like Newton Haven or the new in the new creation, you know, with crowning L'Oreal. I'm sure of it. But I think that, and it's such a shame because I think in that view of God, you just, apart from the impulses that they're mixed, some are good, some are bad, you know. I do feel that they're reflected like by C.S. Lewis and the dwarves in The Last Battle. You know, they're just, you can see, you can see why they reject the network, but I'm like, the network is not God, thankfully, that we know. Hmm. But the one that the dwarves reject, the commentary on what Aslan says, why they still don't accept Aslan despite knowing how good he is, said they've chosen cunning instead of belief. The prison is their own mind. They are in that prison and so afraid of being taken in that they cannot be taken out. So I think absolutely. Gary King is stuck in that prison. He just says, no matter, if there was a greater network, I hope, a divine network that's greater than one presented, I think maybe, I just wish he would think again, basically. Yeah.
Well, you know, if you recast this a little bit differently, I mean, the logical and rigid Vulcans are who show up in the Star Trek universe, which Simon Pegg loves, by the way, right? Yeah. And has starred in.
Yeah.
But like this is First Contact, right? That this is a First Contact movie, just like the Vulcans show up and then Earth kind of has to take that step up and join the rest of the galaxy and become part of the Federation. This is like the opposite of Star Trek. This is where, it's First Contact and we rejected it.
Yeah.
Even in those movies, like even then, sometimes the Federation will be kind of embedded in planets, sort of looking like the people, seeing if they're ready to step up to that. And like here we have the reverse movie. We have the Star Trek where we rejected the invite to become part of the Federation.
Yeah,
like peace out. We just want a party. Shut up. Go away.
Yeah, but that ultimately doesn't end up really good for them because basically go back to the Dark Ages, which. Andy actually has a line where he says, well, maybe the network was right. Maybe we would be a bad influence on the galaxy. Admitting that there is sin. But I also feel like you could spin this in another direction as well, though. I love that you found a way to turn it like Christian, like make the network seem like this could be, the light or whatever. But, like we were talking about, like, it could be very culty and, like, even, like, kind of, like, demon possession, like, We Are Legion style, like, because they're all talking at once and it's, like, We Are Legion. And that, they could be right to fight and oppose that because I do feel like sometimes Christians do want too much conformity and that's, like, when you get cults. And like you said, Rory, God glories in our diversity while also being of one mind and accord. And it seems like an oxymoron, but... we're all have the same foundation on Jesus Christ, but we all have different decor, unlike the pubs in this movie. They are literally all the same. I was thinking of that 1 Corinthians 14:7, just like having everyone still be different. If even lifeless instruments such as the flute or the harp give distinct notes, how will anyone know what is being played? And they were talking about gifts in that passage and how, again, we're all different, but we're all using our gifts for the same purpose. So we're not all the same. But it's just so annoying that the ending is so muddled and that mixed messaging.
So do you think Gary King actually did have a change of heart? He is changed at the end?
I think so. But like you said earlier, Rory, it's like, I don't know if it's James or Rory, I think you both kind of said something similar, but it's like he still got everything he wanted. But he did change a little bit. Like, I think he did feel sorry about what he had done. But then he's maybe the thing is that from our perspective, we think maybe he should have been punished a little bit more. And we're kind of maybe upset that he's still kind of living a good life at the end. he is sober now. It seems like maybe he's trying to have a purpose in life, maybe he's trying to protect these blanks from getting persecuted in a sense because they don't want the blanks in the bar. But we still get the feeling like, man, he kind of got off easy though, But we can feel like that with some Christians and their backstories, and how they came to be Christians and they're living their best life.
That's true. Yeah, I think what I loved about Shaun of the Dead was how clear it was, right? He falls asleep. It's like he needs to step up. I think he writes something on the fridge. It's like, you know, sort life out. That's right. And so you have this very clear and drastic and dramatic change. And in Hot Fuzz, like, both characters needed to change, but they do change less. Like in Hot Fuzz, you know, the one guy needs to learn to take some responsibility. Nick Frost's character needs to take responsibility. And actually then Simon Pegg's character needs to learn how to relax, like how to actually not view everything as so intense and a challenge. And sometimes you just relax and let the goose cross the street. But but here, here we have what's maybe a baby step, right? And maybe that's, like you're saying, maybe either we kind of wanted him to get punished more, or we kind of wanted to see more change. But sometimes life isn't like that. Sometimes we should be celebrating a small step in the right direction and praying and encouraging that. And so it still looks like Gary King may be stuck in his nature. But of course, we also don't believe, we believe that we need divine intervention to actually have real lasting change anyway, right? So, but yeah, it's just interesting that a sermon I'm preaching this Sunday is kind of on how the will gets in our way, right? That's and our willfulness kind of doesn't allow us to you know, we push back on having our heart or our life changed. Where there's a classic hymn is, I take my life and let it be, where the line is like, take my will and make it thine. It's kind of, again, it's a giving self over. And yeah, you don't want to give it around to the wrong thing or the network or which is very similar, you know, one, you know, the greater good and the culty side of things. But the example of Christ is even Christ in the garden, right? Not my will, yours be done. It's like you're looking to the way, you're giving it over to the one above. Because everyone doing what's right in their own eyes, like that's the chaos in the book of Judges. And it's that moment where you have this net, where you have this potential savior is like, I'm going to leave you to your own devices. Like, oh, that's damnation. Like that, there's no greater condemnation than I'm going to leave you to yourself. It's like, oh no. It's muddled, but you know, if we're actually honest, most movies are. I was gonna say, rarely do we come out with. And I loved how the movie here at the end gave us a nice, wonderful gospel message. So we shouldn't be too surprised.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, before we wrap up the episode, here's a little bit of thunder for our lightning round. We've probably already discussed, but if we sum up, we've already said, what do you want to thoughtfully reject in this film? The glorification of pub crawls and even someone who moderates his way around Epcot Center and Disney World is probably not something I'll never do again. And something that should not be probably celebrated or glamorized in some way.
I would take the idea that you shouldn't use friends to enable your enable yourself to complete those sorts of kind of quests and trips, especially if you've got issues, and definitely reject that idea fully. And if you are obviously suffering from mental illness and don't want to, we thoughtfully reject that. People need help. You need proper help. That perspective. Yeah. That's why I think we need to thoughtfully reject that idea. That you should allow people to, just use people, manipulate them into your own schemes.
Not good. Yeah, I thought the main thing, which seemed pretty obvious because they sampled this line quite a bit, is the, what do you want to do? We want to be free to do what we want to do. We want to get loaded and we want to have a good time. And I did a bit of research on where they sampled that line from, because you can tell in the beginning it's sampled from something and they use it in the song. It's actually from another movie from the 1960s called Wild Angels, starring Peter Fonda. It's about a motorcycle gang in California. And just from reading the summary, it's a debauched movie. Like, I would never watch it. I don't want to. But just reading about that made me think again how I don't think this film is maybe endorsing that. Like, I think it's actually saying we should reject that, because when you're free to be a screw up, like James said, you screw up. When you're free to do that, you will do that. Because that's what that movie was basically all about, is just debauchery everywhere and inverting everything that's good. Like, one of the, because I watched the trailer for it on YouTube. Let me see if I can find it. Yeah, on the trailer it said, their every enjoyment is a parody of pleasure. They live for the joys of hell. Which, again, it's like, that's what that line means. Like, we want to be free to do what we want to do. That means you're inverting, you know, you're inverting God's creation. You're not doing what God wills. You're doing what you want. And that's not, it's not going to lead to good things. So definitely reject that mindset, and rather have that other mindset from Peter Marshall, you know, freedom is not the right to do whatever you want, but the opportunity to do what is right.
Meant to that.
Oh yeah, I love the biblical idea that we're right. I mean, we're freed, not we're freed from, but we're also freed to.
Yes.
And in fact, you know, Paul's testimony would be we go from being slaves to sin to servants of Christ. In fact, it's the same word. You could even say servant or slave to sin to becoming a willing servant or slave to Christ. That's been, as Christ took on that same servanthood and took on a slavish role to free us from that sin by coming in the flesh and dying on the cross. So yeah, it's very much a countercultural, counterintuitive. It's an idea that's hard. Yeah, that's an idea that's hard to receive. Even if we're honest as Christians, it's every day. Sometimes it's still an idea. Like there's a little bit of part of the frustration with Gary King is probably that there's a little Gary King in all of us. So.
Yep.
Oh, well, what else can we receive or redeem in this movie, you guys think?
I think this is one that Gary King rejects, but we should receive. I mean, there's a small scene with this goes under the heading of good pastoral guidance from elders. And I think, you know, so in the UK, we would have a guidance teacher who would perhaps advise you on growing up and getting a job, etc. And Mr. Shepherd. That's a good name for a pastoral guide-wise person, isn't it?
I never thought about that. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah. Played by Pierce Brosnan. And Gary, you know, was offered that guidance. And what do you want to do with life? You know, that wisdom and his future and everything important. That's quite a hinge point in life. And he rejected, if not probably ignored, if I'm honest. Being Gary King, he was probably oblivious, thought, I'll just live my life and see how it pans out. And that leads him to despair and destruction for himself, his mates, and ultimately mankind. If you think about it, it's that rejection. He wasn't thrown a bone. He was thrown a big bone of wisdom early on, but he was like, ah, yes, Mr. Shepherd turned out to be one of the aliens in the end, but you know, you can't help but think that what if he was more tuned in. Like some teenagers are a bit, well, whatever, mate, you know. And I feel like, you know, in a similar way to Solomon being offered wisdom by David and his father David, you know, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Gary is a fool. Gary is the example of a fool. He says, for the simple are killed by their turning away, and the complacency of fools destroys them. But whoever listens to me will dwell secure and be at ease without dread of disaster. Go. Yeah. So that's one big idea I think we can definitely receive in that respect. What do you guys think? Yeah. What do you receive, reject, or redeem?
I feel like we pretty much covered it. I don't know. I can't think of anything else at the moment. But again, I agree with James. I think there's more to reject than to receive. But yeah, good point though, Rory.
Well, I think we covered the two different angles you could take with this movie. And maybe that depends on who you're seeing it with or what you want to talk about afterwards. But certainly, I would say reject the idea of turning down that voice from above that actually does want to conform you to something that would be better. Mm-hmm. And this movie almost has, and I think it's probably a little bit based on some interviews and things I know about Simon Pegg and Nick Frost. They're not religious guys, and they would, if not outright atheists, would push back on, you know, they would see God or just see it all as religion and say, yeah, just flip that off. We like, don't turn it down. It's like, well, that felt very much like a reject. But as you mentioned, Maddy, like, you can turn it into a redeem by recasting it not as God, but false religion, cults, even legalistic Christians, or the world trying to get you to, again, hey, it's just, you can add, calling us into their version of what our identity should be or where it should be placed. And so yeah, you can redeem this movie in that way without endorsing all Gary King's actions.
Exactly.
Even a fool can make the right decision, you know, once a day, something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. I mean, that's why I would say there is a bit of redemption. I mean, even if it was a bit wrong-headed, his quest, I still think he does feel like a stranger in a strange land. I think there's that theme we can sort of pick slightly from how he feels about life, and he feels alienated. Yeah. I think, UK, we perhaps feel the same way. You know, we've had the Starbucking of pubs. A lot of the good old traditional ones have closed down. They all look the same. A lot of them do. It's true. The menus are the same. The beers are the same. and I think a lot of British people do feel a loss of identity, character, and community. Who am I supposed to be? You know, I'm supposed to conform or challenge this? It's a kind of, these are kind of ideas that are floating around here. And I think they're in this film as well, and as well as the culture. That's why you won the Brexit vote a few years ago. I don't want to mention it too much, but take back control or just remain. It's a very British way, remain in the EU. Remain. Just remain as things are. Very British way of putting it. But at the same time, you can't tell us what to do. That's why I think people feel powerless in the face of big corporate extra government entities and, you know, like European Union, Westminster government, perhaps if you're a Scottish nationalist. There's all sorts of things going on there. I think it's not bad to feel a stranger, but it's what you're a stranger. You're walking in faith in Jesus Christ. That is the true. We are Christians. We are strangers in a strange land. And we feel that perhaps the rug underneath has been lifted, and things with people don't agree with us in quite the same way. But actually, okay, we're meant to live as sojourners. We're meant to say no to those sorts of powers we're talking about that are deceive us. So that's not necessarily a bad thing. But I wouldn't go about it the way Gary's gone about it.
Absolutely.
Well, without getting too, again, as Steve said, without getting overly political, there are a certain amount of people who would feel that there's a network or two or three in our culture over here. It's like, use these words, use this, you know, say this, don't say this, or you'll get canceled. Be our kind of robot, or you're going to get shouted down or shut out. And so I can understand the tension or the different frustrations that, and so there's a redeem in that too. You know, as Christians, we, on the one hand, we're called to, in too many ways, be submissive to authorities when it comes to issues of our faith. However, then it's okay to take the boys and get a little Gary King on them. So that's the at least in a vociferous discussion. Let's put it that way. Yes. Not a pub brawl, but. But there are places where we're called to stand firm and stand up for
Jesus
our faith.
Jesus had a brawl in the temple. You know, he had his whip of cords.
That's true. That's true.
Temple brawls.
That's what we should be doing.
That's right. He didn't do a pub crawl, but he did a temple brawl. That's the. Oh, that's probably a good place to end there. Well, this has been good. I appreciate you guys jumping on and reviewing this episode with us.
Yeah,
getting a little bit more of UK culture to go along with it, and our super fan as far as seeing it multiple times. So thank you, Maddy, for doing all the hard work.
It's awesome.
Right on. Well, we have more comedies to go, and a whole month full of them. So. Hopefully you guys will tune in for our next one. But until next time, keep engaging movies and media from a godly perspective. And remember, You are not a mindless consumer or a robot. What you do to me?
Thanks for watching this episode of Popcorn Theology. For more content, subscribe on YouTube. Follow and interact on social media to help broaden the conversation. Check out our archive of past episodes at popcorntheology.com or wherever you listen to podcasts, and consider becoming a patron saint by supporting us on Patreon, which lets you interact, influence, and enjoy exclusive bonus content.